Okay, I have a thought experiment for you. Imagine you use a notes app in your phone over the next 10 years to record everything you think of, your thoughts, your to-do list, your calendar, your contacts. Will that ruin your memory? This is a question that I've had for a while because it was actually the topic of the first video that I made and uploaded to this YouTube channel 7 years ago. And I've been thinking about how this video stacks up to the kinds of things that I make now. So I had it fact checked. I haven't watched this in 7 years because I know the production value is super dodgy and I'm sure that most of you have never seen it. So let's dive in. Okay, here we go. I'm a little nervous.
In 2009, a plane was flying from New Jersey to Buffalo, New York. As it cruised on autopilot at 16,000 feet, it encountered a massive storm front. Approaching the airport, the plane's controls began to shudder loudly, a sign the plane was losing lift and might stall. The pilot took action. He pulled back on the controls, lifting the plane's nose. This was precisely the wrong thing to do. Instead of preventing a stall, he caused one. The plane spun out of control and plummeted into a house, killing all on board.
Both the plane and the house kind of look like they were made by an 8-year-old, which is to say that if you want to get good at something, all you need to do is to do it for 7 years and then you'll be able to make really good arts and crafts. It's like the 1,000 hour rule. All you have to do is do this for 1,000 hours over the course of however many years and you'll be great.
How had this pilot forgotten his basic emergency training? Is technology ruining our memory?
So I think what we've learned about a lot of aircraft training over the past few years is that maybe the pilot never got their emergency training in the first place. Also, there's so many plane channels now, aviation channels, but even like Wendover Production and CGP Grey make all of this plane content. Was this the first popular plane video?
We're all living in the age of Google. When we Google one thing and Wikipedia another, we're not relying on our brains, but on our fingertips. Is it making us dumber?
The iPad.
First, consider there are two types of memory. Non-declarative memory for skills, emotions, and movements, like how to ride a bike. And then there's declarative memory for facts and information, like your phone number or the capital of Australia.
The bike is so bad. Okay, my fact checker has written a note here saying there's lots of other ways we can characterize memory as well. Episodic versus semantic, retrospective versus prospective, working memory versus long-term memory. But she didn't write down any other definitions of those, so if you're interested in further information on them, you'll have to Google it.
So when we use technology to look up information, we're extending our declarative memories. But is that at the expense of what's in our brain?
Okay, a note from my fact checker is that non-declarative memory is correct, but it's important to note that non-declarative memories are unconscious. So we ride a bike, we drive, maybe subconscious? We'd ride a bike. Am I fact checking my fact checker now?
The hippocampus is a major part of the brain we use in declarative memory function. It gives us the ability to retain recall memories about facts like the largest animal on earth and events like your first kiss or the first CD you bought. The formation of new declarative memories relies on both the hippocampus and a region around it, the parahippocampal gyrus.
You know what's interesting about the parahippocampal gyrus is that I never use terms like that anymore because to so many people, to most people, they mean absolutely nothing. So now I'm more likely to say another area of your memory center in your brain or something like that. That is much more vague, except it plays better into a narrative. Lessons from Vanessa.
So what happens when we have information at our fingertips and we don't need to remember facts anymore? Well, the process in our brain of how we form, retain, and recall memories remains the same. What changes is what we choose to form memories about.
Okay, so on what changes is what we choose to form memories about, I do have a fact-checking note that the study is phrased this way, but the authors don't actually show the way that we remember things is different from how it was in the past. So maybe it's jumping to conclusions, you could say.
Instead of remembering more facts, we remember where to find them. This is called the Google effect.
I think the Google effect is such a cute name still.
In one study, participants who were told they could later look up the answers online did not make the effort to remember general trivia. When asked a question, people actually thought about computers and search engines instead of searching their own memories for the answer. The use of external memory systems is called transactive memory and is not new. Einstein once said, "I do not carry such information in my mind since it is readily available in books. Plus, we've relied on other people to remember things for us, like a husband or wife. Now there's a third wheel in the relationship, Google."
I'm so embarrassed to laugh at myself.
And it's connecting us like never before. As for that lump of matter inside of our heads, that's connected too. For our declarative memory, using technology just means we're tweaking our memory hard drive so we remember where the files and folders are, where we can find information, not necessarily the facts themselves. This will probably happen more and more as our relationship with devices grows. But it's not necessarily a bad thing. fMRI scans show that for people who are internet savvy, areas of our brains are way more active searching for information online than when reading a book. In our brains, the hippocampus is still working the same way. We're just choosing to retain the most efficient way to find information, and that's usually online. We're all sharing the work of remembering, and it makes us collectively smarter.
Okay, the whole world of fMRI studies is very interesting. So this is true, but doesn't mean that the internet is making us smarter. Maybe it's not that prior internet experience is causing increased brain activation. It could be that people whose brains are less active choose to use the internet less. Well, doesn't that make us all feel good if we're using the internet more and our brains are more active? But this is another interesting thing about fMRI studies, is that if there is more activity in your brain, it means there's more blood flow in that area. That's how these scans measure brain activity. And what does that actually mean? It means you're using more of that area of your brain, but does that mean that you're smarter in any way? What is smarter? How do we measure that? This is where fact-checking just becomes a whole debate.
It's actually pretty adaptive. The only disadvantage is when you need knowledge on the fly. For split-second decisions, all you can search is that lump of matter inside your head. If you have a burning psychology question,
really
leave it in the
ending.
Comments and subscribe to BrainCraft for a new video every other week.
Please subscribe, but I don't know if I'll be able to answer all of your burning psychology questions anymore. Okay, this is my last fact-checking comment. Overall, the way the internet is changing the way we learn, think, and remember is probably pretty complicated and not fully understood. Welcome to social science research. I actually asked my fact-checker to give this video a mark, like it was a university assignment, and she has given it a B grade. But she has written that most people and the scientists who wrote the first study generally want to make a cohesive, straightforward story, but memory is super complicated and there will always be nuance and contradictory findings. But overall, I'm actually pleasantly surprised by the video. I thought it was going to be terrible, and it had a nice story. There were some cute bits of animation, even if they were kind of dodgy, and some jokes. Maybe I don't make enough effort to make jokes anymore. And I think I had such a low expectation of this going in that I'm very pleased and surprised, which is why we all need to realign our expectations of life. On a more serious note, when I started doing this 7 years ago, I was using an old camera and whatever light was coming through my window. And now I have a whole community. I have lots of documentaries on my channel. I have a YouTube original. Look how far we've come. I'm feeling very grateful to have had a lot of opportunities that YouTube has brought. So thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing. And my biggest thanks goes out to my patrons on Patreon who have kept this channel alive over the past couple of years. If you have the means and you would like to join the community, I will leave a link to the BrainCraft Patreon down in the description. If you can't join Patreon, please share this video with someone or share another video with someone that might make more sense. And give it a like and leave a comment to feed the algorithm, because it's a hungry, hungry little algorithm. Thanks again. Bye.